Yes, good morning. My name is Roland Rösch. I work in the Innovation and Technology Center of the International Renewable Energy Agency. Thanks a lot for giving me the opportunity here to speak at the Costanta Spring School on EU external energy policy and hydrogen strategies. I would like to give some insights about IRENA's work on hydrogen and its importance. And the presentation today that I'm doing here is Hydrogen, Global Perspectives and Policies. I kind of try to adapt also a little bit on the topic of this spring school to look into, let's say, where are there potential conflicts, what is happening on geopolitics, and I'm happy to share some insights there.
Roland, can you go to the slideshow and presentation? Yeah, super, thanks.
Yes, and I'll just open the slides, yes. And 1 second, so I've put this beside. So I work for the International Renewable Energy Agency. For the ones that are kind of not really aware, who is the International Renewable Energy Agency? We are a governmental organization inaugurated 2011 in the Petersberg in Bonn. It's actually the European Commission, but also the German government have been very engaged to set up this international organization. We are now headquartered in the United Arab Emirates, so we are the only international organization in the Arab world, and our membership currently is 162 member countries. And there is another 30 countries in accession to IRENA, so that we will be likely within 2 years a kind of very complete global, well, we'll have a very complete global membership. We have also in Germany the IRENA Innovation and Technology Center in Bonn, where I work at as a deputy director of the center. We have currently about 80 staff working there, plus kind of service and security staff. So altogether, we are almost 100 people. We are also a permanent observer to the United Nations, and we have the respective office there in New York. And so what is IRENA doing? We are, let's say, supporting our member countries in their journey to become 100% renewable, to in principle achieve a complete 100% renewable energy systems. So we are targeting this towards 2060. And we are currently advising the governments in how to do this. We are basically a voice of renewable energy. We participate in events. We contribute, let's say, to the perspectives of what is happening on renewable energies. What is the cost situation? And what is the situation of, let's say, the competitiveness of renewable energy compared to other energy sources? We work on policies. We support the countries also to finance and implement renewable energies. So everything that is related to renewable energies we are doing. Since about 4 years, we also received the global mandate of being the energy sector transformation agency. And let's say we are advising countries to do the transition from the fossil-based energy system to a full sustainable, renewable and sustainable energy systems, also decarbonizing the energy systems in the economies of our membership. So what is IRENA doing? And I will go into the details of this and the history and the background. Let's say you can, for deepening what I share here, you will find several of our reports on the web under www. IRENA.org. We did the first report for on behalf of the G20 in 2018, so the importance of hydrogen from renewable power. This somehow was the start that hydrogen became extremely important for our membership. And let's say from there, we started to continuously work on hydrogen. And let's say in 2019, we did then another follow-up report on behalf of the Japanese presidency to the G20 on hydrogen, a renewable envoy perspective. This is report you also find. We are had organized also innovation weeks two times, where we looked into the innovations and what is going on the technical and development side and on the cost side of hydrogen. We had two ministerial roundtables at the IRENA assembly in 2019 and actually in 2020, where we discussed about hydrogen and the global hydrogen economy and how this can contribute to decarbonize the energy systems. We established in this year, I was, let's say, personally leading to set up a collaborative framework on green hydrogen, where we have 62 member countries of IRENA strongly engaged. And we also cooperate here with the Hydrogen Council, with the World Economic Forum, with the International Partnership on Hydrogen and Fuel Cells in the Economy, and many more partners from the private sector, where we open up a dialogue of what needs to happen with regard to green hydrogen, to basically that hydrogen and specifically green hydrogen has the possibility to fulfill its role. Other information I'm using here in this presentation is the Reaching Zero report. Let's say IRENA is since about in cooperation with the German government and in cooperation with the Berlin Energy Transition Dialogue, which happens at this moment in time in Berlin, kind of contributing every year with scenarios. And let's say there we look, let's say the past, since last year, we look here into the 1.5 degrees scenario from the Paris Agreement. So that means to stabilize the world global temperature on an increase of 1.5 degrees. Before we did this on 2.0 degrees, but let's say to come to 1.50 degrees is much more challenging. And that would mean to decarbonize fully the global economy. And let's say the 2.0 target means that will be till 2050, there will be about 15% of the CO2 emissions we have as of today will remain in the system towards 2050. But now, just today, we are presenting a report where we show that the technologies and the measures are in place to fully decarbonize the technologies, which of course is an additional financial achievement, or kind of additional costs are needed for this. But I'm also referring to this Reaching Zero report, which outlines the technical possibilities to decarbonize the full energy systems, global energy system. Then I'm using here our electrolyzer technology cost report, which outlines the way, because for green hydrogen, and the conversion stream is through electrolyzers, and let's say the costs and the assumptions and how green hydrogen can help to decarbonize the economy is basically in this report, and I will share some insights here. Sorry, I just overjumped. So what is, why is there this renewed interest in hydrogen? let's say hydrogen is actually, I recall when I still was going to school, Mercedes-Benz as a car manufacturer had a hydrogen car ready in the mid 80s. And then they did not follow up on this. And just now, since 3 years, 4 years, hydrogen is again on the list of activities. So what is the reason for this? So the reason is that net zero carbon requires solutions for hard to decarbonize sectors. We see that the renewable energy implementation has led to a situation where the cost since 2010 of solar photovoltaics came down by 82%, by 82% of concentrating solar power. This is also getting almost competitive now to fossil fuels on 47%, on onshore wind on 39%, and then offshore wind and 29%. I will share some insights there and some additional information. It's just amazing that there are contracts signed now for $0.02 per kilowatt hour of electricity for 20 years in a 200 megawatt plant in the United Arab Emirates, but you see similar situations in some countries. And let's say these low costs, especially of photovoltaic, has bring the hydrogen economy and the possibility to use green hydrogen to decarbonize the economies brought back on the agenda. So falling renewable electricity costs make green hydrogen a feasible solution. So with 550 to 55 kilowatts of electricity are needed to produce 1 kilogram of hydrogen. So hydrogen can be, and hydrogen is not an energy in itself. It is like, let's say, the wire that carry electricity. It is an energy carrier. Hydrogen is a compromise solution for the renewable industry and the gas industry. There are several other products that can be used based on hydrogen to decarbonize also the gas systems. It opens an interesting transition pathways also for today's oil and gas exporting countries. So let's say also with blue hydrogen and also with electrolyzers, but also other technologies, there is a possibility also for the oil and gas exporting country to look into the option to basically produce lower carbon related fuels. Hydrogen is already widely used today. So 2/3 in industrial application. And let's say the current hydrogen used now is gray hydrogen based from fossil fuels, so from gas and coal and others. And actually the current, and I will give some more details here, current hydrogen production globally has the same amount of emissions as the UK and Indonesia, for instance, together. So if you talk hydrogen, it is not as of today a carbon-free fuel. So this is thing is very important. So hydrogen is not yet a panacea. It is in a way still difficult to handle. So infrastructure and some possibilities are seen there. Specifically, green hydrogen is still very expensive, is not competitive to gray hydrogen or blue hydrogen. And let's say it needs a lot of things need to happen that green hydrogen is available to use it really to decarbonize the energy system. It's a fairly low cycle energy efficiency. And let's say there is clearly a need if we want to decarbonize the economies, we have to move away from gray hydrogen. So I spoke about the perspectives and the expectations of the costs of electricity. So let's say if we want to come into a low carbon economy and if we want to use a green hydrogen, and the only solution to decarbonize energy systems and to be in line with the Paris Agreement's objectives, we have to have a green electricity in place to use them in electrolyzer. And let's say for this, we need cheap electricity. And there you see, let's say, if you look at this gray shadow here that reaches from $5 to about $15, this is the cost range where fossil fuels operate in. And you see here for solar PV, we are already fully competitive, also looking into figures from 2080, but additional scaling up and innovation will make even, let's say, come down in average to 0.4 kilowatt hour, and we expect even more falling prices till 2050. So the same is here for wind offshore, but also wind onshore and hydropower and geothermal. I don't have listed here. They are also fully competitive. And these low costs of renewable energies is the key driver for the energy transition and for the production of green hydrogen, which is the case I describe here. So let's say, what is the pathways we have here, looking into the possibilities to reduce here, let's say use hydrogen. So you see, you have the electrolyzers, the electricity comes from renewable electricity. Then you have the possibility, let's say, to use this renewable electricity and store it, and you use it directly through electrification. This is for IRENA the main avenue for the decarbonization. So the level of using electricity globally is increasing from 21% of electrification share to almost 50%, so to 45% globally. Then we have chemical energy storage and batteries, and this possibility to store and use electricity from renewable energies. And then we have the streams that go into the hydrogen production through electrolyzers. And there you can use hydrogen directly as a direct use. So you can, in many manufacturing processes, for instance, in the steel industry, but also in trucking and others, you can directly use hydrogen. Then you have the possibility to combine hydrogen with nitrogen, which gives you ammonia. Ammonia is a possibility, let's say, that is used already in fertilizer production. There is quite a good infrastructure for ammonia, and ammonia seems to become a solution for the very hard to decarbonize sector of shipping, and also using ammonia as a possibility to transport hydrogen and use it also in the industry, but also in other sectors. So mainly our transport sector and the industry sector. If you combine hydrogen with carbon oxide, CO, then you get methanol. And if you combine it then with CO2 again, so this is another sink then for CO2 in a way, you can combine CO2 from carbon capture storage, combine it with hydrogen, and then you have synthetic methane, which has the completely same kind of chemical composition as the natural gas. And let's say that allows you, but also hydrogen allows you to use the current gas infrastructure. So in the long term, power fuels need to be sustainable. That's very important. So we need to scale up. And let's say the hydrogen, according to IRENA, can only come from green energy sources. Otherwise, the targets that are set will not be achieved. Let's say scalability, affordability, commercial availability, and let's say a match of a demand of supply is a key thing to ramp up to this energy hydrogen economy. So how can we use hydrogen in detail here. So mainly you can use it in the building sector, in the, let's say, in the industry sector and in the transport sector. So decarbonizing transport is a key thing. So via e-fuels for rail, aviation, and in the maritime sector, maybe also with biomethanol and other biofuels or synthetic fuels in conventional vehicles. These are the option to decarbonize the transport sector. I have to move all the time the screen. The decarbonizing the industry sector, there you can replace fossil fuel produced hydrogen. You can replace also, let's say that this is where we currently use hydrogen. You can replace it with green hydrogen. You can replace fossil fuel based fuel stocks. And you can, for instance, also use commodities, let's say, that help to decarbonize the steel sector. So, for instance, one example is here iron pellets. Decarbonizing the gas grid, there we are now just working on very substantially. We look into the possibilities to already blending synthetic hydrogen-based fuels into the current gas grid. Let's say we see that up to 20% of hydrogen, and also, of course, if you can achieve it and deliver it, also the synthetic methane can be used in the gas grids. And that, thus, it, this is a way of provide seasonal storage. You can kind of also use the hydrogen production as a backup and as a possibility to stabilize the electricity grid, which is impacted by variable renewables. And if you have overproduction of variable renewables in your system, you can flexibly use it in producing hydrogen and go then further in the value chain to produce other synthetic fuels. And this opens the door to use and to use the gas grid also to transport. So we, let's say in many of the member countries we have, there is a bottleneck by electrification and transporting electrons from the site where you produce the renewable energies to the site where you need the electrons on the demand side. And there the gas grid infrastructure to use molecules to transport in a country and across borders is a possibility also to reduce the transport problems that are related to the energy sector transformation and the high shares of variable renewables. What is important there? What needs to happen on the policy side? And there we see four pillars for the green hydrogen policy making. We see that national hydrogen strategies are needed. So research and development programs are already in place. Also, we now see that 62 member countries of IRENA already have either vision documents, roadmaps, or strategies in place on how to set up and enter into international hydrogen trading and international hydrogen policies. I see that the government has an enabling policies in place, so advisory councils and sectoral tables, workforce developments, code standards and regulations are coming, level playing field, research priorities are defined. Very important is the production infrastructure and end use. And let's say the European Commission has already started there to look into the guarantees of origin. So that means if you deal with hydrogen, you have to have clearly an understanding from what sources and what happened along the value chain of this hydrogen. and you have to measure and calculate the CO2 emissions that are related to this hydrogen carrier. And let's say to have these systems of guarantees of origin in place is a precondition before you start to use hydrogen to decarbonize the economies. And then let's say the fully infrastructure production capacity, the infrastructure and where to use then. So the demand and supply match of hydrogen is a key problem and needs to come into place, and policies have to be established. So let's say targets of production of hydrogen, specifically green hydrogen, building up the infrastructure needed and to give the security for the investments of the private sector and support the building up of the infrastructure, but then also the use of the hydrogen and the derivatives and the synthetic fuels in the economy, and make sure that while you support the supply, that you have a demand also there at the end. So that's very important. And that's the drivers for the policies. A very nice case of a hydrogen strategy, which kind of entails all these elements, we have seen from the European Commission that on July this year set a target. So they have for phase one till 2024 a goal of 6 gigawatt of green hydrogen product, or green and blue hydrogen production. They want to have to the 2030 40 gigawatt of green hydrogen in place. And then they want to have a large scale use of hydrogen till 2050. Of course, as we know from the discussion with the Commission, they also have to go into more details of their strategy in making sure how this can be used and if there is really a commitment to a hydrogen economy. So production prices here for green hydrogen, they see to achieve at least a benchmark of 1.5 kilogram of production price basis here. The benchmark is the 1.5 kilogram coming from a gray hydrogen. And let's say coming with green hydrogen below this benchmark is the target here. So looking into our global renewables outlook, as I said, we are just working now and presenting in the Berlin Energy Transition Dialogue, the new VETO, which we call the World Energy Transition Outlook. This is from the GROW. So from the last year's report, there you see, let's say we have to look into all sectors to decarbonize the energy systems. So we have to look into transport, district heat, the power sector, building sector, and industry and energy process. And let's say in our, we see that in our planned energy scenario till 2050, actually not much is happening. So these are the business as usual scenarios of the countries of the world. And let's say with this, we are not going to achieve the decarbonization. We have to enter into the transforming energy scenarios, which is in line with the 2.0 degrees objective of the Paris Agreement. And there you see 80% of the measures to decarbonize the energy system are coming from either, let's say, renewable energy directly. They are coming from electrification, using more electricity from renewables in the system. And they are coming from energy efficiency. And they are coming from related derivatives and synthetic fuels that are based on green hydrogen. Other opportunities are related here to carbon capture use, carbon capture storage, but also using carbon capture storage in combination with biofuels, which creates actually a situation that you have negative carbon emissions. And with this, we see already the technologies in place to decarbonize the energy system. If you go into the deeper decarbonization scenarios to achieve the 1.5 degrees, then we have a much tougher case. So this is this lower part where we have to take additional efforts. And these additional efforts would mean to look into ways to decarbonize the shipping sector, the aviation sector, and the industry sector. Just to give you some figure for the business case, so the business case as countries have planned, we expect till 2050 about $90 trillion of investments into the energy system. So 90. If we go to the transforming energy scenario, we expect about $120 trillion of investments into the global energy system till 2050. So about 30%, about $30 trillion more. But then the energy systems would be decarbonized. We would be having clean renewable energy in place. And we expect actually a lot of socioeconomic benefits coming from the energy sector transformation, so that we would be actually be balanced. So we think actually the case of the transforming energy scenario can be achieved without additional, it's a zero game. With the deeper decarbonization perspective, we expect additional about $20 trillion. So that means this last mile of decarbonizing the last 15 gigatons of CO2 emission will cost about additional $20 trillion. And let's say that would be additional costs. But of course, it can be used in the COVID crisis also to overcome in the longer term, looking into this to stimulate the economies. I think I showed this slide already. So where is this all coming from? A combination of 5 emission reduction measures could, if applied at scale, reduce industry, transport, and CO2 emission to zero. I mentioned already, so this is looked at, let's say, in reducing demand and improved energy efficiency, using clean renewable electricity, direct use of renewable heat and biomass, indirect use of these derivatives and clean electricity via synthetic fuels and feedstock, and then the use of carbon dioxide removal measures. And with all this together, we believe that we can fully decarbonize the industry sectors and also the transport sector. And let's say these technologies are already in place. Talking about hydrogen today, let's say hydrogen is used at scale at a feedstock, and this has not changed very much, of about 8 exajoules. There is large consumers. A lot of this hydrogen goes into ammonia production and is used in oil refineries. Only about 4% of this hydrogen comes through electrolyzers, which is a little bit of a problem because the electrolyzers are needed for the green hydrogen production, and the scale up of the electrolyzer production of hydrogen is important to come to this green hydrogen production. I don't want to go now into the details where the green hydrogen is used. Important is here, 8 gigajoule of hydrogen are already in place. This is coming from gray hydrogen and has emissions which are similar to the CO2 emissions from the US and Indonesia together, so quite substantial. And important is to ramp up the electrolyzer capacity and to come here to the production of green hydrogen. We see that, let's say, and there will be, and IRENA believes that we need about almost 30 exajoule of hydrogen in the system to 2050. Also, while electrolyzers are needed, we believe that there will be blue hydrogen in the systems that can come with carbon capture storage and carbon capture use. And then, let's say, ramping up the production of green hydrogen, so that about of this 30 exajoule, about 20 exajoule will come from green hydrogen. So how are we going to do this? And this is now coming from our electrolyzer report that we just launched last November. It is important that we reduce the capital cost of electrolyzers by scale and learning effects and innovation, because there is only a very low number and capacity of electrolyzers in place. Doing this, we have to do a trade-off between, let's say, the use of the electrolyzers, so the hours of operation, the efficiency and the costs. And let's say there is innovation needed looking in using a special types of membranes, and also to reduce the compression in some technical spheres. And there, different technologies are in stream. So scaling up, let's say, the number of electrolyzers, but also scaling up the scale, so the gigawatt scale of the electrolyzers is an important step to reduce the cost, especially the CapEx. And it is very, other kind of innovation stream goes into modular systems, let's say, to have cheap modules which you can combine to different sizes to produce gigawatts of green hydrogen. I don't want to go into these technical details, but let's say there is possibilities in innovation, in scaling up, in learning, where we see a possibility to come to the hydrogen capacity that we need to enter into the green hydrogen economy. If you look at this graph here, looking at the levelized cost of energy, which for an economist reflect the lifetime cost of per kilowatt hour. And in this case, looking at hydrogen of a price of kilogram per US dollar per kilogram hydrogen, then you see in places, and this is this brown bar on the left, if we go to places where we have already the cheapest prices of green electricity available, so 20 US dollar per megawatt hour, there is some sites in the world that we have those prices. I just mentioned the case in the UAE. There's also a plant in Mexico, and let's say mainly in the Sun Belt, there are places where you have levelized cost of energy of 20 US dollars, so 2 US dollar cent per kilowatt hour. At those places, with the current CapEx cost of the electrolyzer, you can be already competitive to the cost range of gray hydrogen. But let's say the realistic situation is we have to look into the double price of green power, which is 40 US dollar per megawatt. And there you see we are not competitive. And let's say what IRENA sees now and what we are supporting is the manufacturing and the scaling up and the innovation on the electrolyzer side to bring down the CapEx from 840 US dollar per kilowatt installed to 200 US dollar per kilowatt installed. And then we will come to the CapEx we need for the green hydrogen economy. And that's a very important point to be made here. Let's say that this is also not kind of impossible. Let's say some believers in fossil fuels, they say it's not possible. But I think we have seen similar innovations and scaling up on the side of photovoltaics, and there are realistic views that we have that this can happen. This is some additional graphs looking at the importance of CapEx and price, and looking into price and operating hours to come to the prices we need. So these are the main drivers. Looking here at the comparison, so here we have the case, let's say this greener scale here is what the avenue we see with electrolyzer costs of the upper end of $1,000 per kilowatt, at the lower end of 650 kilowatt. And then with this price range of green electricity we are seeing, we expect that we can follow these green lines, where we already into 2030 reach a level of competitiveness that will have help to use green hydrogen already where you use gray hydrogen as of today. And then scaling down till 2050, we can look into the opportunities in using green hydrogen to decarbonize aviation and shipping, and also using it, green hydrogen production, for decarbonizing the steel sector. So there is a story we believe in, but of course this would kind of need a substantial scaling up from where we are today. We have to kind of scale up the synthetic global demand 5 times till 2040. And when we then are in 2040 and the decarbonization of the shipping sector, the aviation sector, which make about 5% of the world CO2 emissions at the moment, then we have to double from 2040 to 2050, and we may achieve our targets. This is, of course, needs to be supported with a significant scaling up. And let's say this needs a scaling up of the markets. While we are at the moment on stage one and stage two, where we have single sites where hydrogen is produced. Also the oil and gas industry with its refineries, they already have hydrogen pipelines which connect different hydrogen sites, refineries where hydrogen is used. And there is also truck and ship transport of hydrogen, so that we are somewhere between stage one and stage two with the semi-centralized systems. So now building up, and let's say some policies have been taken forward to build up the policies, the infrastructure, the certification schemes to build a national hydrogen strategies in Germany, in Europe, and in national countries. And then the next step is the intercontinental trading of green hydrogen, which is coming, which is already in political discussion. There have been already agreements being signed between the Germans and the Moroccans. And there are other countries now at IRENA. We see a lot of developing countries that are already at 100% renewables. Costa Rica, Uruguay, but then also Canada with high amounts of excess hydropower. They are interested in entering into trading and shipping of green hydrogen. And there is a lot of work we are doing at IRENA to connect the dots to enable international green hydrogen trading, because apart from wires, green hydrogen trading is the carrier for us to use more renewables and also to trade across kind of oceans, green hydrogen and renewables with it. So what is here the challenge? Hydrogen can be, and let's say till 2040, let's say competitively, it can only be produced in the sun belt of the world. So ranging here, let's say at cost-efficient ways. So you can consider, everything which is around 2.4, 2.6 US dollar per kilogram of hydrogen. So that means there will be likely a situation where countries in the north will have to import, while countries in the Sun Belt may have the possibility to export hydrogen, green hydrogen. Of course, this is looking into solar, because solar has the most competitive advantage at the moment. I think other opportunities may come also with hydropower production. But let's say there is clearly this situation with the solar belt, and which creates this situation of trading hydrogen. What we see here is, and I see just the time is running. See here that some countries will need to import hydrogen. So this will be Germany, this will be the European Commission. And this is a situation where already countries like Europe, Japan, and also the US are planning for green hydrogen imports. This needs clearly, this certification, a common taxonomy, and this guarantees of origin to trade the hydrogen economy. Very important is also to look at the stranded assets. So stranded assets of the fossil fuel economy may become a blocker to the energy sector transformation. And this is extremely important to look into ways on how the current gas infrastructure, for instance, and the existing fossil fuel structure can be best used for hydrogen, also for electrification, to avoid stranded assets and to avoid that country, especially oil and gas country, enter into a very difficult situation with stranded assets, which may not make them adaptable to the energy sector transformation and the greening of the economy. A last word about our IRENA collaborative framework. IRENA collaborative framework is a framework where we bring all these aspects of the green hydrogen economy together. We discuss with the private sector what is needed to come, along this map that I described for the green hydrogen developments, to trade and use green hydrogen wherever it is needed to decarbonize our energy system and the energy economies in general. Thanks a lot for your attention. You can find all this information also on our webpage. I hope that was an interesting presentation. Thanks to the to Michaela and Michele and Osika for the invitation. And it was a pleasure being with you, and I hope it was an interesting presentation. Thank you. Back to Michele and Osika.
Thank you so much. We have a few follow-up questions. And we still have 3 or 5 minutes. So we can start with Sanya. The question is a bit long. It's located in the chat. Do you think you can locate it and read it? So I don't have to repeat that for everybody.
Okay. So basically, I have 3 questions. Thank you very much for this very informative lecture. This is very interesting. But yes, I of course have some doubts. So first of all, I did not really understand. I'm a political scientist, so I really do not understand this division on colors of hydrogen. So you mentioned also gray, green, blue hydrogen. What is the difference? And does this difference somehow influence this capital investment cost concerning this division? This might sound like naive, but I really do not understand this part. This is a chemistry part, so I'm not really strong in that.
It's more about where is the hydrogen coming from. And let's say you can of course use coal and gas, and then while you produce hydrogen, then you have also CO2 emissions, which are basically carried with the hydrogen. So this is gray hydrogen. Then you have blue hydrogen, which mainly comes from gas, and then you separate the CO2 emissions while producing, so, and you store it or you use the CO2 emission somewhere else. So this is called the blue hydrogen. Then we have the purple hydrogen. So this purple hydrogen is coming from renewable energy, let's say from fossil fuel sources, but you use shares of electricity that come from renewable production. And then green hydrogen is a fully decarbonized hydrogen that comes only from renewable sources. So that's the difference. And let's say, while especially gray hydrogen is not acceptable for the plans the world economy has to decarbonize, it can only be, according to IRENA, but also according to some partners, it can only be blue or green. And let's say that the discussion between the different parties is how much will it be green and how much will it be blue? And let's say, what is the prices and the developments? That's the answer to this question.
Great, this much clearer. Thank you very much. And I also have I will go to my third question. When you speak about transition deadlines or wishful deadlines for this transition, do you consider only the EU, or because you mentioned also some agreements between Morocco and Germany, and you also mentioned Costa Rica, Canada, they were involved. Now, when you said in one of your latest slides, you mentioned that this is possible to produce, hydrogen is possible to produce only in the areas with a lot of sun. So my question would be like regarding politics, and I think this is one of the biggest obstacles probably. How do you plan to involve the countries that are also oil and gas producers and exporters like Russia, that are located mostly in the north, in these areas where there's no much sun, and to motivate them to use hydrogen to transform their economy towards more renewables? That is my main question. Thank you.
Yes, of course. The let's say for the oil and gas countries, this hydrogen discussion is in a way interesting, because with carbon capture storage, but also with pyrolysis or others, there may be a possibility to at least produce hydrogen at lower CO2 emissions. And let's say that will help them maybe to use longer time the fossil fuels in the system. So this is one thing. But then I specifically worked a lot in the Russian context. And for instance, Russia, of course, it's a huge country. They kind of a little bit behind in the implementation of renewable energy kind of generation.
A lot.
But they are looking, yeah, maybe a lot. They are looking into possibilities to maybe produce more green electricity and then also produce green hydrogen from this. But of course, Russia is also looking into the possibilities in how they can decarbonize their gas by blending in hydrogen that is already decarbonized. So that this is an option. And of course, I don't know. I know that the German government is having discussion with several countries in, let's say, what can be done to, let's say, it's clear that Germany, the European Union, some countries, they have to rely on exports of hydrogen, let them be green or blue. And let's say, these are things that have to be discussed early on, let's say, to make this happen. And these discussions are already going on. But let's say till the green hydrogen economy kind of comes to play as full, that will be towards 2040, 50. So that will take many, many more years.